Hi, and hello, football fans. It's your old pal Dave, Dave Dameshek. What's going down? I hope all's well wherever you are. Welcome to the Dave Dameshek Football Program, presented, as always, by McDonald's. Yes, McPick 2. Go get you whatever two items you want on the McPick 2 menu. It will only cost you $2. In Studio 66, it is a banner day because we are joined by the face of the NFL Network, handsome as all get out. Can I get him? First question is, can I get you some McDonald's McPick 2 items? Pick whatever you want. I'll have someone run out and get it for you. It's Dan Hellie, everybody, from Total Access and Beyond. What's the poop, fella?
I'm just glad you finally had me on. I mean, it is the end of the season, but it's the playoffs, so I'm assuming this is a slightly more important show than a regular season show. So I'm glad I'm here.
I've had you on before. Don't play. Don't start off with jive.
A year and a half ago.
A year and a half ago.
Untrue.
Well, what did you do?
I've been around.
Don't play games.
Waiting to be asked out.
Mr. Fancy with those. I you know what? I can't get too cross with you with those beautiful baby blue staring back at me. Also, let's say hello to the man seated to my immediate left. It was his birthday earlier this week. He's 48 years of age.
It's true.
doesn't look a day older than 44, though. Here he is all the way from London, England, our resident Miami Dolphins fan. It's Handsome Hank. Handsome. Hello and happy birthday, Handsome.
Thank you, Dave.
How are you?
I'm very well indeed.
Yes. Any sort of insight into the human condition now that you've made another year?
Nothing in particular, no.
No?
No.
All right. All right. Let's just get to pro football.
I mean, let's get to pro football. I'd
like to know how old you really are.
Really and truly, yesterday I was 39 years old.
One more year until the big 4-0,
exactly.
Well, right. We'll get into a little bit of that and perhaps the game called life. But as Dan Hellie mentions, the postseason obviously is upon us. Championship weekend is nearly here. Coming up here, we're going to talk about who we're loving going into the title games. A little game that I don't know if we're going to have time for, so I don't want to promote it. Well, I'm going to mention
promote
football
it.
Player or not. We'll see if we have time for it. And then the Red Challenge Flag Pick segment this week. We're calling it the McDonald's McPicks.
Ooh.
Clever.
Actually, I sang that last week when we did it.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Oh.
Red Challenge Flag.
Perhaps
McPicks.
Inspired it. So, all right. Let's get into it here, and then we'll have some time. But you know what I'm loving? Let's get to it. Who are you loving going into title game weekend? Before we get to the proper ones, Dan Hellie, I have to say sincerely, saved my bum a couple of weeks ago. I'm not going to go into details, but what a sweetheart. You over and above, there are not a lot of people in the business that would go out of their way.
Anybody would have done.
No.
That is not true, and I'm not going into it.
People will now be intrigued. What was it? It was melodrama. It wasn't any actual real life.
I don't know.
It did seem kind of dramatic.
It was dramatic, especially with you delivering the news.
Exactly. Dave doesn't do melodrama. You only do real drama.
It was very real in the moment.
It was silly 100%. In the moment, but still, Dan Hellie saved my bum in many ways, so I appreciate that. But he is, of course, a DC pro football fan, mm-hmm. So perhaps we can dig into that. Right now, though, who are you loving, Dan Hellie?
I am loving one 32-year-old, not 39-year-old, 32-year-old Larry Fitzgerald.
Hmm.
Fitz just getting it done.
I'm surprised. You know what? I can't believe he's only 32.
He's only 32. It seems like
he's been around forever. Yeah. 12 seasons in the league, right? He goes three straight years without a 1,000-yard season. Everybody's riding off Fitz. He is done. And then what does he do this year? Almost 110 catches. I think he had 109 catches, 1,200 yards, 9 touchdowns. And then not only does he have the 75-yard catch and run to set up the game-winning touchdown, he takes in the game-winning touchdown on a run. I love it. Yep. I love it.
How can
you not love what Larry Fitzgerald has done? I love the Cardinals in general, mm-hmm. from Arians to Fitz to Calais Campbell on the defensive side of the ball, but I'm loving Larry.
Boy, oh boy. It's almost verbatim what we've been talking about. Yeah, Arians and that gang is a super likable bunch. If you're looking for a team to get behind here on Sunday, I would say the Cardinals are a great one.
I think both of the NFC teams are pretty easy to like compared to the AFC teams.
I suppose, but the Panthers lost a little of that charm.
Yeah, yeah.
After what happened with the Giants when they paid him a visit with the baseball bats, a lot of America jumped off that. And then been a lot of 12s up in Seattle are writing cross letters about Cam Newton. By the way, how that that bit of ridiculousness.
Yes.
That continues.
Let's move on from that.
It makes me crazy. Yeah. Handsome. Why don't you lay on us who you're loving?
Oh, I'm kind of loving the. So obviously it's Manning Brady 17. We've probably must be the millionth person that's mentioned that this week. And it's not at the same time because it's really not about Manning versus Brady this time around. And so Broncos fans are getting very upset when they're told that it's really not about Manning versus Brady. The stat that I really like that are a crack research. Search team, Drew Stanton, he's not part of it actually anymore, so I'll ignore that. But Tom Brady has thrown more touchdowns at Mile High this season. He played one game there than Peyton has, who played in six games there. Thrown three. Peyton Manning's thrown just one.
Not more. Three times as many.
Three times as many.
By the way, why would Broncos fans be upset if you said it wasn't about Manning versus Brady? Because if it is about Manning versus Brady.
Then they're going to lose.
Then they're going to lose,
but
right.
I don't like being told that Peyton isn't as good as it seems right. Bizarre to me, but right. I tweeted this stat out yesterday and got vitriol from Broncos fans who are like, yeah, we know, but that's not going to make any difference on Sunday. Kind of is.
Here's the thing. I love Peyton Manning. Literally, I have a man crush on. Not only did we go to UT together, we graduated the same year he graduated.
You knew him there?
I knew him a little bit.
Really?
Yeah, I knew him a little tiny bit. Was not friends with him, but he would hang around in the same circles. So I've always rooted for Peyton Manning.
Right.
Peyton's the 34th rated quarterback in the NFL. 32 teams, by the way. No team has ever advanced to the Super Bowl with a quarterback who had the same metrics as Peyton Manning. It's never happened, and it's not going to happen this year, unfortunately.
Oh, a little spoiler alert for the
sorry.
A little early.
No, I love it.
A little premature prediction, boys.
Do you have any good stories about Peyton?
I can tell you this. I remember.
I can't think of where they are. Knoxville, Tennessee.
I remember as a freshman, there was a guy named Jerry Colquitt who was the starting quarterback. Heath Shuler had left, so Jerry Colquitt was the starting quarterback. Todd Helton was his backup.
Sure.
And then Peyton came in with a young man named Brandon Stewart. Brandon Stewart would later transfer to Texas A&M. But they were the two hot freshmen coming in. Colquitt got injured. Helton, who was also a baseball star, obviously, at Tennessee, got moved into the starting quarterback position. Didn't play great. I think he was a little banged up, too. So Peyton Manning and Brandon Stewart were splitting time. And I actually really became a fan of Brandon Stewart. He was more athletic. He could move around in the pocket. Here was Peyton, this gawky 6'5 kid from New Orleans coming in. And I said, man, Brandon Stewart is a much better quarterback. That shows how much I know. Two games into the season, they stopped splitting time. Peyton Manning went on to be the SEC freshman of the year, and the rest is history.
Definitely on the wrong side of history.
You know, by the way, the Broncos fans, as you mentioned, and a lot of Broncos fans in the last 7 days or so have dropped me a line and said, hey, just so you know, Dave, we're not all kooks about the Broncos thing. You're not a hater because you don't root for our team and so on. We're embarrassed by the behavior of the Broncos Twitter handle and the people that are hitting you up.
Right.
So
is the Broncos Twitter handle getting on you?
Dave,
oh, really?
Dave's in a
yeah.
public feud with the Broncos.
That's fantastic.
It is great. I think it's a lot of fun. I'm amused by it, but it's weird because whereas the Panthers and Cardinals and Jags, off the top of my head, Seattle, the Seahawks, have funny people running their things. Like, it's hard to go back and forth with when you zing somebody, but they don't get the joke, and then they try to respond with a bad joke.
With a bad joke.
They don't understand
why
it's a bad joke versus a good joke.
And then they try to make you feel bad.
Yeah. Well, you're a comedian. You should be able to do better than that. Ha ha! They zinged you, Dave. You're just critiquing my joke. You're not actually making a joke yourself, which exposes you.
We need to find out who runs that handle.
What we also need to do.
Dave knows.
I know. I'm too classy, though, to
yeah,
make
you really
that
are.
Public.
Yeah.
But I will say that what's fun is what we should do in the off season. First order of business are the types of sports fans you encounter on Twitter and social media. I think we could put together a great list. And I'll tell you, if your entire Twitter thing, your page or whatever, is all pictures of your favorite football team, that's going to be a red flag going in. You know, those people are not going to. If your Twitter handle includes the name of your
favorite football team,
you're probably going to be irrational in dealing with any sort of critique of how they're playing.
I'm assuming that Shek doesn't subscribe to my theory that you just kill them with kindness after they criticize you on Twitter.
I love it. No, I there's no chance. I crack wise with them. I try to crack wise.
Yeah, I think sometimes you've done that. I like to thank people.
They don't make me upset because the goal is to anger you. And
do you retweet the criticism?
Yes, I love retweeting the criticism.
Well, I've never really fully understood that.
Here's what you do. Because what you're doing is you're holding out the racket, the fast-paced stupidity that they're serving you.
And you're hoping that
I'm holding the racket out and let it fire back, and it does.
We'll
bat them back.
That's correct.
Can someone explain to me, actually, while we're on Twitter, what is the point of a mute button? Why don't
my assumption is because you don't want to hurt feelings professionally or otherwise. So yeah, I'm following you, Dan Helly, but then I mute you, and then you don't know I don't have to endure.
It's not
your,
just block them.
Right. How many people do you have muted on your Twitter feed?
I have no one. Who would I follow? But then mute. I would never do.
Well, that's my point. I don't either.
Yeah. I don't know.
Maybe I have some people muted.
That's why you never respond to me.
Handsome Hank and Dan Helly, certainly I keep you open. I want to hear what you have to say on all matters. All right, what am I loving? I tweeted during the Steelers-Broncos game. Of course, I make no secret about the fact that my team is the Steelers. And I tweeted, after trying the reverse jinx for 3+ hours, and in fact, in front of that, I kept tweeting out, Steelers have no chance. Just save dignity, save the jet fuel, and stay home. Don't even make the trip. And beyond, all through the game I was doing it. But when I decided to pick my spot, I decided to declare, go 180 degrees the other way. I declared, when the Steelers score, and they will score. Yeah, I went Norman Dale at the end of Hoosiers. Mm-hmm. I said, when they score, and they will score, I vote to go for two. Little did I know, on the Pittsburgh Steelers sideline, a man named Mike Tomlin was saying this to his team.
We never going for two when we score. We never going for two when we score.
I want to get hired now. I love it. See? That I love that Mike Tomlin and I share the same headspace. We park our cars in the same garage. I love, by the way, what I don't love is that Cleveland guy on the radio disparaging Catherine Smith's hire there. But what is her title?
Special teams quality control.
I don't want to be special teams quality control. I just would like to be
two point conversion quality control.
Maybe because I legitimately think that would have been the right move for Pittsburgh. Had they scored.
It was the right move for the Cardinals.
Well, that's what I was just about to
get
to. I think that in both cases, if you have – now, listen, if you're – even if you have Peyton Manning because of the two-yard play, but if you believe in your quarterback, which certainly Mike McCarthy believes in Aaron Rodgers in broad strokes, and so does Tomlin and Roethlisberger, isn't that the better move to go for two in that spot? Why risk the coin flip? How many times does Mike McCarthy now – I can't imagine going forward that he'll ever go to overtime again and say, yeah, let's just see what the coin decides. No, go for it. Well, that's too big a risk. Really, one play, 2 yards, you have one of the two or three best quarterbacks in the game, which the Packers and Steelers do, or we can debate the top five, whatever. Don't you think that's the better bet, Dan Helly? Then going to overtime and a coin flip and all that?
It's all about the odds. In my mind, from the two-yard line in any situation of that ilk, it's a 50-50 proposition. Yeah. It's a 50-50 proposition. And if they feel like they go to overtime and you get the coin flip and one other thing goes your way, then all of a sudden maybe there's a 70% chance you score.
I do think that that because of what Mike Murphy –
But
Mike
you have
McCarthy
no control over that. So, I mean – you
True.
I get that, yeah, if we do, then we have a 70, but the first layer of that is winning that 50-50
thing. I think the biggest fear for coaches is if we don't make it, there's going to be criticism. This is the easy way out.
I agree.
Choosing
to
go to overtime is the easy way out. And obviously, they're criticized for their decision-making, and they're forever. Somebody could have criticized.
But next time that happens, at least for Mike McCarthy, he can point to, look what happened the last two times we went to that.
No, great point.
So
absolutely.
I think for him, any other coach still has to have.
Well, there's a get out of jail free card next time.
But he now has. Look, last two times we went to the playoffs. This is what happened to us. At least let's.
I want to make it clear because Phil Simms on Inside the NFL said everybody who is saying that Mike McCarthy should have gone for two there is just using 2020 hindsight, and those are the same people that would have destroyed McCarthy had he gone for two and failed in that spot. Oh no, incorrect. I think I say that in advance of that. That's the play. Why? I don't understand the desire to with that touch. First of all, overtime should still be modified, certainly in the postseason. When the stakes are as high as they are, do it like soccer, a full 15-minute quarter. That's what you do, and what the final score is at the end of that quarter.
No, that's too much.
It's not too much.
Each
too
team,
much what?
Team
too much fairness?
Each team should have one possession, but 15 minutes is...
So,
So but you don't get one possession. You don't get one possession.
I'm saying each team should have. If they're going to modify the rules should be modified that regardless of
when
you
get into
a
that weird. Then you get into
that college
junk, which I'm not as hip on as everybody else. Suddenly the nature of the game is different. Hey, we're not kicking it out. Just start at the 25-yard line. That's a weird move. I don't love
it. Is it better than it was?
No, I really like.
Of course it is.
You can't win with a field goal. Otherwise, you just go 30 yards, kick a field goal, game over, and then Aaron Rodgers still didn't get the ball.
Some of the great, you know, here's the thing, everybody.
You're making no sense.
I don't understand how you're
making
one argument. And
the goal for we fans is heightening the drama. And to me, when you have a 2-point conversion, but no overtime, and you saw this happen many times, some of the most famous games in college football history came down to the decision. 1983, the Orange Bowl, Tom Osborne could have kicked an extra point, tied Miami in the Orange Bowl, and won the national championship with the Nebraska Huskers. Instead, he said, no, I don't like that. I don't like the spirit of that. I'm going to do what I should do, go for two. He missed it, but to me, a hero for all of time for doing that. Conversely, was it Air Parsegian? I believe it was. In 1970, undefeated Michigan State and Notre Dame, he did kick the extra point instead, kicked the extra point rather than going for two, and won the national championship as a result. There's no courage there. I want courage. Football, it's more fun.
How do you deal with him on a daily basis? What he's saying now makes no sense.
I don't know what I don't know what you fail to understand. I think you need to pick two from the McPick menu and get some food on your stomach and some wisdom in your brain.
Clearly, the majority does not rule here, Hank. But
doesn't matter. Called the Dan Hellie football program.
That's a good point. That's a good point. But the overtime is better now than it was.
Yes, I would agree.
There's no doubt in my mind.
Dave doesn't, but that's
no. All right, yeah. No, I thought you were saying is college football better with that, but is pro football better? Yes, it is definitely better.
Oh, you just misunderstood the question.
I misunderstood.
That was the result of the 5-minute rant that we just had.
Well, I hope you're
– I do agree better, but can still be improved upon.
I'm not going to argue that.
Okay. Yep. All right, let's get now to very important stuff. And like I mentioned, it was Handsome Hank's 48th birthday or whatever it was. And this begs the question, Dan Hellie, Handsome Devil, Handsome Hank, though, the gold standard these four halls. And what also is intriguing about Handsome Hank's appearance is that a lot of people think he looks like other people. And I wanted to go through the top three that I've come across here. The first one, the first time I met Handsome Hank, I declared he looks very much like this guy, the late, great Chris Reeve, circa Superman 2, early 80s.
Oh, I could see that.
Yeah, see, doesn't he look like Clark Kent / Superman from Superman 2? That's Handsome Hank, different hairdo. Doesn't he look a lot like him? Look on YouTube if you're listening on the airwaves. Otherwise, I assume you can conjure an image of early 80s era Chris Reeve. Secondly, The New Bachelor. I can't think of his name, but I've been watching it, and it is spellbinding.
Boy, they
are overflowing with kooks in this season. Tune in now. How about this? There's a woman on the show. One of the contestants was an Austin – Dan Hellie, you've been around the block, local news guy and everything.
Sure.
She is a local news woman in Austin, Texas. She quit her job to go on The Bachelor, because she's in love with what's his name? I really can't.
How does she know this guy? Was he on a previous?
She watched him in a previous season.
Right.
That's not as outrageous.
It is.
By the way,
it's not to quit your
Austin's
an anchor job. How hard is that?
60th biggest mark in the country. She could have been at the end of a contract. It's not as crazy.
Maybe.
As it sounds.
Yeah. All right. See,
he doesn't look anything like me.
Well, that was a Matt Money Smith observation.
Little bit.
Disagree with that.
The Christopher Reeve is on point.
And then the other one, of
DJ,
course,
yeah.
Daniel Jeremiah.
Yeah.
My American cousin.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I contend that they may have been birthed by the same mother and then, for whatever nefarious reason, split at birth.
Right.
One shipped to the UK, the other shipped.
But destiny brought us back together
to the West Coast
at NFL Media.
Continental US. All right, Dan Hellie,
That's pretty good.
Vote. Who's best? Who's he most like?
DJ, undoubtedly.
Most like Daniel Jeremiah. Yeah. Behind the glass, anybody want to weigh in there? Goth kid?
Goth kid.
I agree, Daniel Jeremiah. I think that's
Jeremiah.
Yeah.
Well, wow, he's looming right over his head. Again, look on YouTube. Yeah, that's – boy, you got – that's really crazy how much you two look alike. I'll stick with Chris Reeve because of the physique. You have the same strapping, broad shoulders. I feel like the world is in good hands as long as this Handsome Hank is in charge.
Yeah, I can't fly as well as Reeve can.
now, but I'd like to believe they're made of steel. All right, now let's get to we'll see if we can come back around to the little game show event that we want to play. Right now, though, let's get to, before we make our picks for the title game weekends, let's get to the wizard himself. Football baby, now 70 and 30 lifetime, I believe.
Who knows? You make it up every week.
He went 2-2 last week. He won both on Saturday, lost both on Sunday. Here he is with the two title game picks for you.
Football baby. The baby who picks football games.
Only four teams remain, football baby. It is title game weekend. Choose! Carson Palmer, Cam Newton, two Heisman winners, only one winner. Point to the champion. Who will go? Round and around. Round and around. Touch. Cam Newton. Congratulations, Carolina Panthers. Tom Brady, Peyton Manning. Who will Cam Newton's Panthers face? Tom Brady's Patriots!
Football, baby.
There you have it. You know, hard to argue with the decision to make.
Argue.
Did you see how demonstrably he chose Cam Newton? One! Put the one digit right on that number.
Yeah, he
one.
Agrees on Cam. I'm not sure that your Patriots pick that you gave him is as
strong. I gave him nothing.
You gave him?
I didn't give it
really?
To him. You saw as he grabbed for that iPad, he clearly hit the Patriots.
Accidentally
before he
hit the
Broncos.
Patriots a second.
How can you accuse him of any accident at this point? There's no accident with football baby's magic.
True. That is true.
One thing that I also noticed there in the weird I don't know what to make of this. I recognized. Did you see when Peyton Manning? Of course, everybody saw when he went down and then popped back up. Clearly, gamesmanship. Obviously, he told Emmanuel Sanders. In fact, if you see me do that, break out to the sideline. That means he calculated that he was going to do that. It didn't lead to anything, but nevertheless. Yes, it's not. That's right. Like I say, if it's a felony, it goes from a third degree to a first degree crime. He knew what he was doing in advance. This wasn't a crime of passion.
Why would Emmanuel Sanders tell anybody that?
Take a look. A few weeks back, Akbar Bajabiamila on Game Day Blitz assaulted me. He attacked me.
Can we see the video of it?
Well, I don't know.
It's always entertaining.
I don't know if Hellie saw it, but look at that. You know what? Why Peyton and I ultimately don't get along? Too much alike. See that? All fours. Look at us. We're both on all fours again. Watch this on YouTube. Look.
That's your best side.
It genuinely is.
All fours. That's how we both wound up there.
It does. Without any explanation, I think Hellie is wondering what he's looking at.
Why would you?
Akbar
Bajabiamila, for some reason, showed how his pass rushing technique. He blew past.
You mean the one that got him two NFL sacks?
The name, straw. Oh, he gets very upset if you bring that up.
I know he does. That's why I did it.
Well, he has three NFL sacks now, counting the one when he got the potbelly Jew. But Mark Iztok, a French fry named Mark Iztok, provided little resistance in the pass rush.
That's what you call Iztok, a French fry?
Well, I don't know. What is he, a string bean? I don't know what you call him. But anyway.
He definitely isn't a god.
Akbar Bajabiamila blew past Iztok, providing no protection for Dameshek. Before I knew it, he dropped the hammer. And I wish we did have the
Did he go low? Did he go high?
No, no.
How did he take you down?
He tomahawked me over the shoulder. It hurt.
He tomahawked you.
He really did. He's
That could explain the sack.
But total. Like Peyton did on that play, I popped right back up. I went right back to the huddle. Next play. Now we're going
You limped back to the huddle.
What happened, and I'm not going to apologize for what happened. All right. Let's get to it now, and I would like to see that, though. Maybe you could share that with the audience and put that in afterwards to remind them of Akbar's assault.
It's a good reason to check out the other episodes as well on YouTube. If you guys want to go back.
Oh, that's coming awfully close to sass, goth kid. That felt a little sassy.
No sass.
All right. Let's get to it now. Instead of the Red Challenge flag pick segment, today we have the McDonald's McPicks.
McDonald's McPicks. McDonald's McPicks.
Presented by McDonald's McPick 2 for $2.
I thought it would be to the same jingle, right. Like McDonald's McPicks.
Yeah, that's kind of what we did last week.
I know.
I need to learn. It'll take me a few weeks. So I need to learn the words to that.
McDonald's. What was that that jazzy little number there by the one man house band Dick Banks? Excellent stuff. Hellie, you play your cards right. You might get a theme song if you become a regular on the program. We'd love to have you.
I can't even imagine what that would be like.
Well, Ike Taylor and Reese Jones-Drew have their.
They have their own theme songs.
Well, just this handsome. Week. Just this week.
They can we hear?
19 weeks after the
Oh, it took
arrived.
Them a whole season.
Took an entire wow, season.
As much as you love Ike and
that was,
MJD.
Right. That was laziness on my part. Can we hear either of
Maybe
those
Maybe Dan can
jingles?
See if we give them a rating.
Yeah, that'd be great. Can we hear?
Number 24 is in the house. Ike Taylor's on the show.
Woo!
Dick Banks is a musical genius. He didn't do a whole lot of didn't do a lot of background work on Ike
Taylor. The background work was limited.
Wait, so he wore 24 and his name is in fact
And he's
Ike
going
Taylor.
To be on the show.
He's on the show. Yeah. Now here's
all
the
accurate.
One.
Yep.
5'7" full of sexiness. MJD is on the show.
That is spectacular.
When Maurice heard that for the first time, even before the jingle had finished, he interrupted to tell everyone he was 5'8.5".
I don't know that he's 5'8".
I don't think he is either, but that was his first reaction before it had finished.
That's great.
Next order of business, Dan Hellie gets a theme song. All right.
Let's work on that.
The next order of business is making the Red Challenge flag picks here. A little something, though, that we do need to cover. And by the way, we mentioned that it's presented by McDonald's McPicks. Again, I mentioned pick two items on that menu for $2 and fill your belly with some tasty and tender vittles. Before we do it, though, I think we need some stakes. These are big games that are coming up on Sunday. So here's what I propose we do with the McPicks menu. Whoever wins between the two of you gets to choose not just two items, but the entire McPicks, and it'll come on my dime. It'll come out of my pocket.
Okay.
Very generous of you.
If it costs me $6, I'm going to pay it.
You'll pay it anyway.
Maybe $8 it costs. I don't know what it's going to cost, but I'm going to get you every item you want and then some. But only you get to eat it, and the loser has to sit and watch.
I think
sit and watch in shame.
What if
just
we
watch
choose,
the whole
what,
thing?
Just out of interest, what if we choose the same teams through this?
Well, I have a plan for that. Why don't we make it? We can decide whatever we want. We could do what quarterback will have the most passing yards or something.
All right.
Like
tiebreaker.
We'll find a tiebreaker.
Yeah. All right, let's get to it. Now I'm excited for this. Time for the McPicks title game edition. Patriots. Broncos, Dan Hellie, choose.
This isn't even going to be a close game. It's unfortunate, especially considering my love affair with Peyton Manning. But Tom Brady is going to march in to Mile High, and Julian Edelman with a gimpy Chris Harris is going to help him dissect that defense. I think it's going to be a 2-touchdown victory for the Patriots.
Handsome Hank, how say you? Go ahead. Oh, and by the way, Hellie, you have not been a part of the Red Challenge flag. If you hear something you disagree with there, if you hear a pick that you disagree with, you throw the Red Challenge flag.
Okay.
I actually was visited by some NFL Network upper-level people who said, if you're going to throw a Red Challenge flag on Hellie, just don't go for the face.
Well, of course, that only makes good sense. Yeah. You're hurting the entire operation.
Bring,
if you
bring
that.
The whole thing.
That's
down.
The moneymaker.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what they call it. That's
but luckily, I don't need it this time because I agree with them. I think the Patriots are going to win that one.
I don't like fist bumps. I want acrimony. I want one of you watching the other
that
one.
That wasn't
eat
the
food.
Game. That wasn't the game to do it. If you want acrimony, the Patriots are going to win this one. I think they're going to win it pretty easily.
Well, here's the thing, the first point I'll make about why I think the Patriots are going to win. I agree with you. The main reason I think is practically the virtue of the Broncos above all else is their ability to really heat you up. And that is a danger if you're the opposing QB, especially with an offensive line in the state that the Patriots is. And even if Sebastian Vollmer is out there and 100%, which it doesn't seem that he is, that is a bad offensive line. When Edelman's out there, however, you'll notice that it was not a factor, even though a few pieces have gotten hurt along the way for the Patriots on the O-line. But you'll notice that wasn't a big looming issue for the team as long as Edelman was out there. Why? Because obviously Brady negates
long
a heavy
handles,
pass rush.
Basically.
Right. The quick passes to Edelman are basically unstoppable, Edelman back in there makes it moot that Von Miller and DeMarcus Ware, largely at least, that they're going to be able to get to Brady. He won't allow that to happen.
Right.
It's all going to be short passes. That's my number one football reason. Yes,
well, the Patriots don't have to run the ball to win. The Broncos have to run the ball
right.
to win. There was a crazy stat that I saw a couple of days ago. Tom Brady is 4-1 in the postseason when he throws the ball 50 times or more. The other however many quarterbacks since in the Super Bowl era are 3-38 when they throw 50
times. It's a desperation play. You know, whenever you see that, you're like, wow, that
But not for
struggled.
Brady.
Right.
And the fact that they don't have to run the ball to win and they can use Julian Edelman as a running back of sorts with those short, quick passes, I don't see how the defense – they'll slow them down. I don't see how they stop them.
In these type of games as well, you know, we have spent the whole week talking about the Patriots offense, which is, you know, around the best in the league, and the Broncos defense, which is around the best in the league. And it normally comes down to the opposite of that. It comes down to the Broncos offense, which hasn't been very good, and the Patriots defense, which is
pretty good.
Pretty good, but better than average is probably a good way to look at it. And Belichick, and it seems blasphemous to say it, but Belichick, who's known for taking away your best thing, which in this case is probably the Broncos running game, is going to be saying, Peyton Manning, beat us. And I just don't see that happening against that Patriots defense.
Well, you saw, I mean, certainly the Steelers and anybody else applies that same
right.
method to defeating the Broncos, and again, they largely did. And the defense, those wonky games, the defense stole another one against Pittsburgh by forcing that turnover. And I do want to say again, the two key plays to me, Bradley Roby is not getting nearly enough credit. Fitz Toussaint is taking a lot of heat in Pittsburgh and elsewhere that was the decisive play, and I suppose it was, but it was more about Bradley Roby. That was
a good point. That was
spectacular. I mean, he jumped in there and punched that ball out and knocked it loose, and then a minute later in the game, Emmanuel Sanders got around just in time to knock a sure pick for Willie Gay out of Willie Gay's hands, and that obviously would have swung the game in Pittsburgh's favor in all likelihood, too.
Does Will like being called Willie?
That's what Ike Taylor calls him.
He does?
Yeah.
Oh, then he's good. Okay.
I call him Gay Island. Don't visit wide receivers. Emmanuel Sanders almost paid the ultimate price, or Peyton almost did by paying.
I'm glad you brought up Roby, though, because I really do think with Chris Harris Jr. being basically playing with one arm,
right.
that if Roby can fill that void and he's just adequate,
yep.
then they might have a chance. But Harris is the best slot corner in the league, in my opinion. And I think when you have him, you can kind of neutralize Edelman. But if you have Edelman and Gronk out there, you can bracket one guy, you can double one guy. But that means the other side is going to be one-on-one, and you have to win that matchup.
And every week you go into a Patriots game, and every team has, like, here's my plan for stopping Gronk. And nobody,
right.
nobody
we're going to jam him off the line. We're going to be physical.
We're going to bracket him. Nobody can do it.
Yeah, and by the way, as far as that goes, I would be very surprised if you don't see Aqib Talib matched up with Gronk in addition to one of those linebackers yep. trying to bracket him a little bit. It makes too much sense to me, and that's something Belichick will occur to him if it occurred to Dameshek. The other thing is this has nothing to do with football. I don't like when 100% of the football predictors out
yeah.
there, including us, decides on a result, and it seems like everybody's saying the Patriots. That's a red flag, because when everybody says something, it doesn't happen in the NFL. Go all the way back to August. Kelvin Benjamin got hurt. Well, now the Carolina Panthers are done. Nobody gave them a chance. Things when there's certitude to that degree, it always goes the other way. And more practically, I do think – and that's why I really liked Pittsburgh's chances going up to Foxborough this time around if they could have gotten there. I don't always think Pittsburgh's going to win. In fact, I usually think they're going to lose to the Patriots. Tom Brady happens to own them. But in this case, I think you can bang that team a little bit up front, that front seven. And I know Mayo's but the difference is there. Jamie Collins. People keep talking about Edelman wasn't out there, Amendola wasn't out there when the Broncos beat the Patriots head-to-head. As significant as Jamie Collins.
No doubt.
Those wheels, if he's right, I think that running game might have a push, but you're not going to see C.J. Anderson snapping off 40.
And they're apparently not worried about him being right.
Right.
You know, obviously the back issue is there, but it's not serious, and he's going to be out there, and he should be full bore.
I know. I'm intrigued to tune into NFL Total Access this evening at 7 p.m. Eastern.
Yes, we'll have a couple of Patriots on the show.
Find out if Heath.
Why? Who are you going to watch
Willie,
it?
Yeah, who and Heath and Willie are going to choose?
Good for you.
One.
The first it'll time be, this season, you're excited to tune in.
I'm always excited to tune in, but this is one where, you know, I really want to get those two guys and find out who they're going to pick in this game.
All right, let's move on.
So you're mocking. You're mocking, us. You're not just mocking me. You're mocking all of us.
I'm not mocking.
Total Access staff.
That's not true. I didn't mock anyone.
Let's move on to the other game. And by the way, is that a TV thing? Is that just a rights thing that, or is that a decision that the NFC game is on after?
I think they flip every year.
They do flip every year.
Pretty
I guess
sure
that makes
do,
sense. Yeah.
Are you just guessing, or do you know that?
I'm. It's an educated guess.
I think.
Why wouldn't you just put the more attractive matchup?
Because
later?
It was decided on It was decided on Wild Card weekend.
The prime time.
Or when they laid out the entire postseason schedule after.
To me, Panthers Cardinals is the more attractive matchup.
But is it the best ratings matchup? You know the way they look.
Ratings go, and so this is paradoxical for me to say. There will be more casual fans who know about 8 or 10 NFL names,
right,
two of them being Brady and Peyton, who will tune into that one because they know it has some meaning beyond just a standard football game. But real football fans, this indulgence of everybody loves to say, can't get enough of these two guys going ahead. I was like, I don't know. I was over it 3 years ago. All right, Arizona Cardinals, Carolina Panthers, Handsome Hank Choose.
So difficult. This is the game I've wanted to see all year.
Yes.
So excited about being able to see it when picking the Panthers.
Ooh, Dan Hellie, how say you?
Oh,
Hit him with it, Hellie. Throw it at him.
I understand that the way the Cardinals played last week, it's going to lead some to say they're going to get pounded by Carolina. But I think, and Nate Burleson, who's also been on NFL Total Access a number of times this week, is one of the guys who said if any team is built to take apart this Panthers defense – it's the Arizona Cardinals.
Yeah.
And I think that last week they had a game plan that was really conservative. They wanted Carson Palmer to get comfortable. I think they're going to be aggressive. I think they're going to try to take the top off the defense. Josh Norman doesn't always travel. He's more of a Richard Sherman type who kind of stays on one side. He never goes in the slot. And I think they're just going to work those guys. And I can't always be as objective as I want to be. I just really like the Cardinals as we were talking about earlier. And I would like to see them – get it done. I'd like to see Arians get to the Super Bowl. And I think they have a really good chance. And let's not sleep on that defense either, which is one of the top 6 or 7 defenses in the NFL as well.
Boy, man, I agree with you. But I also, to Handsome's point half an hour ago, I think Cam Newton leading the way, that's a very likable team as well. And I'd love to see him stick it to the Byzantine thinkers in our 21st century society. I'd like to see him hand it to them and dab to the world, to all those haters out there.
That many Cam haters out there still?
There's a weirdly high percentage of it. By the way, my pick is I'm taking the Carolina Panthers. I'm going to take them at home. But you know what, Hellie? The more I think about this one, the reason I'm picking against the Cardinals is because I kind of buy the ebb and flow of the NFL marathon, as you always hear the cliche about the team's got to get hot at the right time. Well, the Cardinals are not hot at the right time.
They lost.
They got
games.
Whipped by the Hawks in Arizona. Then they got lucky as all get out to survive the receiver. I mean, Jeff Janis was catching passes against them. And Aaron Rodgers just about had them beat. Were it not for a fluky tip pass at the goal line, you don't know that game even goes to overtime.
The beauty of it
was
it
a fluke. There are plenty of examples of a team surviving a game that they had no business winning, and then never looking back and running the table. So that's a possibility too. But the Cardinals are inarguably not playing their very best.
And I'm about to argue against myself. But the beauty of that team is everything about them. They're playing with house money. You got Bruce Arians, who was supposed to have been retired 3-4 years ago. You got Carson Palmer, who sort of came from the wilderness. You've got Fitz, who suddenly come back from 2 years again in the wilderness to do things. I just feel like, talk about a team that can play free regardless of whether they're at home or playing on the road. They've got nothing to lose here. They just play like a team.
No, I get what you're saying. But my biggest concern too, again, now I'm arguing against myself like you, Handsome Hank. Cam Newton is obviously the X factor for the Carolina Panthers. And the Cardinals like to blitz a lot. But Cam Newton is great when teams blitz him. And that's what actually scares me. So it's like steel on steel here. Who's going to win? I can't wait to see this game.
But
the Patriots-Broncos game, I think, is going to be boring to an extent. Mm-hmm. this game is going to be
But
awesome.
last weekend we sat and we said that the Cardinals-Packers game was going to be one-sided, and exactly the same way we just said about the Broncos-Patriots one, and that was a thriller, and then the one that we thought was going to be a thriller, the Panthers-Seahawks, was 31-0.
Well, that's what's great about the National Football League, fellas.
We don't know anything.
Oh, he's going so corporate, he went National Football League.
He dropped to National Football League.
In this league, gentlemen.
Expect the unexpected.
This young man at the quarterback position has an opportunity to do some very special things.
In the National Football Conference title game.
Somebody did actually.
Someone did drop
National Football Conference.
Really?
That was a new one.
I'm going to do that on NFL Total Access tonight.
Yeah, that's a shout out to us if you do that.
I absolutely will.
All right.
You have my word.
That's your birthday present, Handsome
Hank.
Thank
you. That's it.
And we'll see if you get another birthday present next week when you get to eat McPick items. Yeah. In front
Wait,
of
so now what do we – oh, so do we – we don't need a tiebreaker.
Well, the last question before Hellie goes off to do his fancy TV stuff is who – what quarterback and his legacy – and I know Peyton gets very raw when you talk about, that's not the narrative, put it in your bum and all that stuff. What QB stands to gain the most in victory? And not just this week, but, I mean, by hoisting the Lombardi in 3 weeks.
Cam Newton.
Hmm. Because.
I think so. Well, first of all, I'm not even including Peyton in the conversation because I don't think it would happen. So you could make the argument that Peyton winning that second Super Bowl elevates himself to the cream of the crop in terms of the all-time greatest.
I think he is third. I think if Peyton Manning wins the Super Bowl, even by hook or by crook, in the same way that John Elway gets this weird credit for winning a Super Bowl and Dan Marino didn't, and he has two rings, Elway has that. Oh, everybody knows if you watch the trajectory of Elway's career, was he was handing off there. That wasn't his team any longer.
Sure.
He didn't win in his prime. But still, he'll get credit as you look back on it. If he has two rings, three Super Bowl appearances, he will be statistically. He has all the big numbers.
That's the obvious answer to me. But the reason I say Cam is because then Cam is on the same plane as everybody who's 1-1, who's
That's
still
right.
playing.
Right.
He's Drew Brees. He's Aaron Rodgers. Yep. He's done it. And I don't think anybody thought, you know, after that second year, after, you know, he started fast and then kind of came down and the Panthers really struggled, I don't think anybody believed that he could win the Super Bowl.
Well, I'll say what I find interesting, like you say, the Tom Brady and the Patriots have blown up longstanding assumptions about what's winning ball. Here's how you can't win doing that. Throwing 50 times a game. In the Super Bowl, after the first quarter, they just stopped running the ball. No matter. That's not the way.
And they do that all the time.
Those rules don't apply to Tom Brady. I think it would be nice to blow up all those assumptions. I mean, what Cam Newton's done in the last couple of years is RG3 has fallen away and Colin Kaepernick has, and Ryan Tannehill hasn't gotten as far as people thought he would, and Andrew Luck was throwing a lot of bad interceptions once again when he wasn't hurt here. Cam Newton has continued to play the kind of ball that everybody was talking about 3 years ago. Remember when Kaepernick and the Niners went to the Super Bowl? It's the dawn of a new age. Everybody will be running the pistol or some variation on that. And no one's doing that anymore with any consistency, save Cam Newton and the Carolina Panthers. And I think he is obviously a special talent. He's going to be the MVP. But he is what would vault himself into this different stratosphere where there would be coaches wrongly always say afterwards, hey, we got these Super Bowl rings and no one can take those away from us. Well, those are physical items. Those can be taken away, but no one would ever be able to scratch out the fact that Cam Newton won a Super Bowl if he gets it done here.
We always talk about the elite quarterbacks, the four or five elite quarterbacks. I think he wins a Super Bowl next year. You see people putting him
in that group of whatever it is, five, six guys.
Imagine that, too. And then they'll get Kelvin Benjamin back, too.
That's a scary thought.
Yikes. How good could that team be next year? But we look forward to it. We look forward to watching Dan Helley every night on Total Access. He's the best in the business, and he's as nice as they come, too, which I rate about, like, half as important. You know, like what I like is talent. Talent is what rules.
Right.
But if you're a nice person,
fine.
It's like, that's cool.
Cool.
That can be cool, too.
Throw it in there as well.
I don't really care much, but
really all about.
But above all else, the main thing you say about Dan Helley is a beautiful SOB. You know, there's just no denying that. No one can take that away from you.
I don't know. Your light in the studio didn't really help me out today.
Oh, no. Those baby blues shadows are still singing. Dan Helley, the great. Follow him at Dan Helley. Watch him on Twitter.
That's H-E-L-L-I-E on Twitter. So all your podcast listeners, I hope to see my following go up today.
Peyton Manning's dorm room freshman roommate or something like that.
not true.
Oh, the tales he has not to true. Tell about 18. Or you called him 16 back then.
Back then, yeah.
Yeah. Come on, 16. Come, let's go.
It was a good time. We missed the national championship by a year. It was Team Martin that brought that to Knoxville, not Peyton Manning.
I know.
We never beat Florida the entire time I was there. Four years. He, Shuler, Peyton Manning.
Wait, Peyton didn't come through in the big game.
Yeah. We've heard that before.
Interesting. Yeah. All right, the great Dan Hellie. Now let's get to a new little segment here. Ike Taylor has done one of these. It's great. We'll get you that next week. In the meantime, we visited with DaQuell Jackson last week, of course, of the Indianapolis Colts, and he was dynamite, and we'll give you that full interview later on. But right now, here's a brand new segment where they tell some charming stories. This is called Pigtails.
So there was a guy used to play for Cleveland. I won't say his name. We had a coach that he was just a big prankster. This was during training camp. So he would always come by. We'll check the list to see who's coming by. And we'll give him a hard time or whatever. Won't open our door, whatever. Decided to get a chair, take all of his clothes off, and he had a newspaper. So when the guys would open up the door to check and see if you were in the room, all you saw was, you know, everything just hanging in the newspaper. It was hilarious. But the other story, there's a guy that he plays for the Seattle Seahawks. And love him to death. Played in Cleveland with him for about 5 or 6 years. And he had the worst gas I've ever smelled in my life. But he would always do it in the shower. We're all in the shower. Like, how do you smell through hot water? So it has to be something foul coming out your butt for it to smell that bad in the shower. And he had the worst gas. You know, anytime we were around, if someone, you know, kind of passed gas, we knew it was that guy, man. And he would do it on the field, during the games, everywhere. And, you know, that's one of the things that stick out to me.
Well, that was, I don't know, was that adorable or outrageous? A little scatological.
It was, I mean, it's not my taste, but there you go. Did Nate Burleson play for the Browns and the Seahawks? Trying to remember if he played for the Browns. Played for a lot of different teams.
He definitely went to Browns camp. Was that as recently as last year that he was in Browns camp? I think, I don't know if they crossed over. That's interesting. What did you think there, Goth Kid? Did you enjoy that one?
I really enjoyed it. Keith did a good job.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, it's, yeah, I guess you can listen to that too, but to see the animation put on it, take a look again.
How do you describe that animation?
How would I?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a certain style. It's kind of news, some news.
Very Taiwan news.
If Taiwan you see news.
The exactly. Current events. I remember when Tiger Woods got into his little trouble.
Yeah.
There was a famous one of those going around. You see those. Yeah.
Yep.
It looks like it's that animation style. So we'll have more of those for you and our pals who make the NFL. Bindle Dog, Jay Gish and Company have another Pigtails for you. Like I say, authored by Ike Taylor. It's a lovely story of his first meeting with a famous teammate of his. So we'll have that one for you.
Maybe we need a new NFL for the Super Bowl as well, Dave. Can you put your mind to that?
I would like to do that very much. In fact, I guarantee it. Now, what does everybody think? Who's going to be eating the McDonald's? Who's eating the McPick next week, Goth Kid?
I'm going to give it to Hellie.
Helly's going to be eating it while Handsome watches, eh?
I think so.
You know what's interesting, too?
That would be tough for me. I love a McPick.
I was trying to get through it for Helly's sake because he had to go. But the other factor that's just interesting, I don't know how big either. We talk about the Patriots don't run the ball. But how weird is it to think that Steven Jackson could be a factor
could
in
be
this
a factor
game?
In the-
and so, too, could Monty Ball.
Monty Ball, that's an interesting – I mean, those two guys, they are definitely past their prime.
Has Monty Ball – well, past his prime. Monty Ball's
we never
man
had
of
a
25.
Prime. We never had a prime. That was – I mean, he didn't
he's
have a prime.
He's still on the roster, right? Has he dressed for a game yet?
I don't think he's been active.
Yeah, I don't think he's been in uniform.
But that's exactly – that would be very – he'll probably have – like, he'll be a Timmy Smith style, have 230 yards rushing in Super Bowl 50.
Or against his, or against his former mates.
Team.
Yeah.
If he was Rex Ryan, the coach, he would he'd be a captain this week.
Hands, that's right. I bet. I wonder if he will be. That's
no,
a fun
he won't
story.
Be. I think even Belichick has enough respect for the game to not do that.
Handsome, was it a fun birthday?
It was wonderful. Thank you very much for asking.
Really?
Yes, I had a cake with my children, and they we had cake, and yeah, it was fun.
Did they make you a picture or anything?
They did. I got a picture. I it's always awkward with kids when they make you a picture and they present it. You know, here it. I got this for you, Daddy, and then you're like. That is beautiful. What is it? And in this case, it was a pencil on white paper, and it was like, duh, it's snow.
Well, I know your oldest's how talented he is as an artist.
Well, yeah, he is. Actually, I think some art still hangs in the studio.
Is there any way we could get a camera on? Oh, you know what? Hey, Goth Kid, because I'm tethered here. Can somebody or Nick, can you grab that? For Handsome's birthday, let's show off his first offspring's keen work here.
This was something he produced ahead of the season. He's a huge fan of Dave's.
What I like best is about Nick is that he's doing it on his own clock.
Right.
Nick's like, I'm not going to hurry.
Why
hurry? I'll get you your dumb picture, jerk, but I'm not going to hurry to do it. Yeah, I know it's your normal pace. We're doing a show, fella.
Big Steelers fan, big fan of Dave's. He still thinks that Dave is a former NFL player.
Don't tell him. Don't break his
heart. I haven't.
Don't break my heart.
But
either.
He did make that.
Half the time I like to pretend in my own brain that I was on the Steelers.
I remember as a kid it was always very difficult to draw helmets. And I feel like he's rendered one pretty nicely there.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
I wasn't moving it. I was moving it away so you could see my moneymaker.
Yeah, that's nice.
That's what the ladies see at the bar. Like, right. The gentleman at the other end of the bar has sent you a drink. And when they look over, this is the look they get. You ready? Here we go. Ready? Here we go. I'm going to do it for you. Like, oh, that's what was sent to you by the gentleman at the other end of the bar.
Oh, thank you. That's so kind. Wow. I can see.
Can you imagine?
I can see
that
why
works.
You've had all the success you've had.
You know why? You know why it worked. Yeah, Handsome, why don't you do one here? Okay. Show us how it looks for you.
That good?
Beautiful. Really, we have the accent, so you don't need a lot.
But if I'm at the end of the bar, they don't know that, so I have to show the accent via the use of my eyebrows.
Can I do this one now? This is the guy in the commercials that you see throughout the football and golf stuff is for the male, improvement.
Oh, I see. Male help.
The help
assistance.
Yeah, the assistance.
Male assistance.
Here's like bam bam bam, like hey, when the time is right.
Right, and you're like varnishing a bench.
Yeah, they're varnishing or they're playing miniature golf. Yeah. They're doing precious
like
things
all those things
other,
that make you think.
Suddenly,
oh, now's
yeah,
the
like,
time.
Wait, oh, she, oh, maybe, like, yeah. I don't know, you know what, I'm going to take her temperature just with my eyes here and see where she is. And this is the way that sad sack looks.
I think I might be. I think it might work.
I think so. Yeah. All right, so that's that. Best wishes to the Patriots and Broncos,
absolutely,
the Panthers and Cardinals. It should be.
Give us some good football games.
That's right.
When we say best wishes, what we really mean, we're kind of being demanding. Like, give us like two great football games on Sunday.
Handsome,
please.
Real quick, no jive. What is for your purposes as the person who runs the homepage at the NFL and obviously is it wants to some degree what is going to be the best content, most compelling content. In your mind, what matchup gives us that?
I think the Patriots, for me, we started brainstorming some stories that we might be telling during Super Bowl week. I think the Patriots in Super Bowl 50 going to San Francisco, where the 49ers have probably been, one of the two or three teams you could claim are the dynasty, the most important dynasty of the last 50 years. The Patriots going there and really stamping their authority, and it'd be hard to argue that they're not the number one. I think that's good. From the NFC side, I like, Cam is going to be the MVP most likely, and so I think the Panthers going there and playing against the Patriots would be pretty good.
Think about that. If you have the MVP anointed the night before, going out onto the field against the greatest quarterback of all time. That's fascinating.
That's a good story as well.
Of course, if Peyton Manning is playing for, whether he wants to acknowledge it or not, if he gets to the Super Bowl, he's playing for a bigger stake in the history, the recorded history.
I just think regardless of whether Peyton gets to the Super Bowl, wins the Super Bowl, you still, it's hard to argue that he's better than Tom Brady.
Well, if he beats in title games, if he's 3 out of 4 against Tom Brady, and if he, again, obviously it's the nature
still,
of the game.
But he still rings short of what Brady's done.
I suppose, but if he does something special, I guess that's what would
he's going to have to do something special to get there.
And on the other side of things, I mean the Cardinals are a fun team.
Cardinals are terrific. The stories about more than any, as we went through this brainstorming, more than any of the other three teams, there's some really cool stories you could tell about the Cardinals.
Yeah, and but I also
my favorite one. Can I just tell you?
Yes.
Tom Pratt, who is their defensive line coach, or in fact their pass rushing coach, coached in Super Bowl I, what would be cooler? He was on the Chiefs coaching staff in Super Bowl I. What would be cooler? And hasn't been back to a Super Bowl, I don't think, since. What would be cooler? He's Hank Stram, one of Hank Stram's assistants. In fact, he's in the background when Hank Stram's talking about matriculating the ball down the field. What would be cooler, you know, 49 years later?
Wow, that is marvelous.
Than being a coach in the Super Bowl at the age of 80, I think.
Yeah, that would be
wonderful.
That's
a cool story to me.
I really think the bottom line is, I think the Super Bowl, as far as storylines go, or the potential matchups that you could get, are just about bulletproof.
Yep.
If Peyton Manning survives and suddenly it's this weird upside-down story that Black Tie, to his credit, foretold 6 weeks ago that he's going to be the anti-Peyton, or the season's going to be anti-Peyton, lousy in the regular season, then suddenly do something special in the postseason. Either team from the NFC has compelling stuff. And the Patriots, while it's a well-worn story at this point, is, you know, intriguing for their place in where they stack up against the 70 Steelers and the 80s Niners and all that kind of stuff.
If they win, I think I know which direction you go in, but would they maybe overtake the Steelers?
No, because what you're talking about then is it's a different thing. It's apples and oranges. I guess in broad strokes, rings with the same guys, but same guys means Tom Brady and Bill Belichick. You're not talking about their – what are you
it's
really –
It's not a team. It's more about the franchise.
Like we say, and I don't – their style of ball just is ultimately – I know it's fine. I mean, if I were a Patriots fan, I would say I don't care how we win as long as we're winning rings. But they're efficient, which is not very sexy. Well,
but they've also changed that style for almost every year. I mean, even from last year to this year, it's different.
I suppose. But, yes, of course, they will be inarguably the top four all-time teams because that would be the 70 Steelers in the Super Bowl era. 70 Steelers, the 80s Niners, the early 90s Cowboys, and then this would be the fourth. And then
I think if they win, I'd have to rank Patriots, Niners, Steelers, Cowboys.
Well, you're already wrong. That's crazy. The Niners ahead of the Steelers? It's the same thing. It's Montana is what you're rooting for.
No, it's
there.
Not
you're not
Montana at all.
Team.
That was a team. There was one Super Bowl, which I agree.
All right, so
is
you want
at
to call
the start of Montana's career.
Who's
but
the
then
best
the rest
quarterback
are,
is what you're talking about,
no,
Brady,
no, no,
Montana.
No, you brought up Montana, not me. I'm saying that there was one Super Bowl that was outside of a chunk of 49ers Super Bowls.
All right,
mid,
see, this
mid
is
mid
the kind of stuff we'll talk about.
Post-Super Bowl, let's do it.
I love it. You know what? If they do it, that debate is one for all of time. The final four for all of time. Oh, yeah. I'm onto something here.
I think I was onto it. I just brought it up.
I don't know who you are anymore. Anyway, enjoy the title games. We'll talk to you after those with our pals Ike and Maurice and Handsome and the rest of the gang. Maybe Dan Helly. He'll even have a new theme song by the next time we visit with him. Thanks for joining him. Follow him at Dan Helly and watch him on Total Access. Thanks to everybody behind the glass. And thanks to Keith Black for that nifty little animation there that we just saw. We'll be back after Title Sunday. In the meantime, thanks so much, football fans. It's been a thin slice of heaven. Let's do that look again. Ready?
Find out more on the next DDFP.